the Senate approved a $22 billion external loan requested by President Muhammadu Buhari following an executive session that lasted for over 40 minutes. The approval was sequel to the consideration of the report of the Senate Committee on Local and Foreign Debt. The chairman of the committee, Clifford Odia, read the report and recommended that the Senate approve the request. Prior to the approval, there were arguments between lawmakers and the Senate president that lasted for over half an hour. And joining me live in the studio to discuss this afternoon is Barrister Jide Ologun, public affairs analyst. Thank you for joining us on News on the Hour.
You're welcome.
Now, interestingly, first, the Senate gets to spend about 37 billion naira on the renovation of the House of Assembly. Then our president gets the green light to obtain a loan of almost the equivalent of our entire budget from the Senate. Why our leaders seem similarly, they seem to have an inflated sense of our nation's capacity to actually, get loans, and then the payback of these loans, nobody's really talking about it. How do you react to this?
To start with, it's quite worrisome. I recall that in the 8th National Assembly, there was a request by the president, but the committee threw it out. And at that point in time, Senator Shehu Sani said it was in a bid to prevent the country from slipping into economic slavery. Because whether you like it or not, the borrower is a slave to the lender. And another dimension to this is that while we may argue that if you relate our GDP to the borrowing, we may appear comfortable. But if you relate revenue to the borrowing, we are in a serious crisis if we proceed with this.
Yes.
And the third position is asking a big question. What do you borrow? Because some will argue all nations borrow. I know. America borrows too. But the unemployment rate in the U.S., at the last time I checked, about 6 months ago, was about 3.5%. And the unemployment rate in Nigeria is far above 25%.
Yes.
So when you look at the infrastructural deficiencies we have in the country also, you ask the question, what have we done with the funds borrowed in the past? As we speak now, the megawatts that we generate has almost collapsed in this country. And yet we have spent trillions of naira in that sector of the economy. At the time, the first lady had to shout that the intervention, social intervention fund management was quite disturbing. We spent about $16 million on mosquito nets. And for that point in time, she said that that money was enough to fumigate the whole of Nigeria. So when you look at all this, you must ask a question. How are we going to deploy this loan to maximize the benefits accruable to the people? Or will it just go down the drain? And we have this profile of always painting a brilliant picture.
Yes.
Massive infrastructure. And this time around, the digitalization of the NTA and things like that. You see, there are things we should have done 35 years ago that we are still putting on the paper today. So, but then we have 109 senators, 360 House of Reps member who should be representing our interests. And some ask the question, whose interests are they representing?
Interestingly, representing our interests. Now, the Senate is meant to be checking the excesses of the executive, and vice versa. But apparently, we're not seeing that happening. Rather, we see both of them supporting each other's extravagant ventures. Is this troubling?
The president of the Senate already told us that anything the president pushes to the Senate, we get the approval of the Senate. So it's like, and that's why some people had to express their concern at the time that
isn't that a trouble?
This may be a rubber stamp,
yes,
National Assembly. But then, under the principles of checks and balances, you have three arms of government: the judiciary, the executive, and the legislative arm, and they are supposed to check, counterbalance the governance process. And that's why I made reference to the case of the 8th Assembly. The request was thrown out, but now this House is approving it. But addressing the issue of extravagance, Nigerians have debated hotly and expressed their displeasure on the salaries and emoluments and allowances that the members of the National Assembly, you know, obtain, irrespective of our troubled economy. So we have never seen that reflection of sobriety in how the resources of the country, you know, have been managed. So I'm not surprised if at this point in time, the National Assembly is not mindful of the impact of this on our future, because you can either approach, you can approach the future in one of two ways, securing the future or mortgaging the future. But having said that, if we get this loan and do the right things, the future will be secured. But if we get this loan and it goes the way of the other loans, and don't forget all the Abacha loots that we recovered and have spent and the one we are still trying to recover and everything. So, but somebody said that the politician thinks of the next election, the statesman thinks of the next generation. But we can make some references. Whether you borrow or not, you need to develop the society. Look at the test case of Cross River State, where Professor Benedict Ayade is the governor. You can see his industrialization efforts towards securing the future, because you need to create jobs for the people. You need to drive business activities. You need to attract traffic. That is what the likes of the UAE, Singapore did. And today, they are prosperous regions of the world.
So all right, we've heard that this loan in itself, it's nothing to worry about. It's nothing that will cause trouble. But yet, have we met the criteria to further indebt ourselves as a nation?
You need to ask the question, who is saying there is nothing to worry about? Look at the level of poverty in the country. If this government made a promise to migrate 100 million people out of poverty in 10 years, that is half of the population. So half of the population of your country is in poverty, and you are saying there's nothing to worry about. I mean, they need a checkup. I mean, and it only reflects the fact that they are not responsive to the pulses of the people. There is hardship in the land. There is poverty in the land. Education neglected. And in the midst of all this, we are constructing a rail line to Maradi in Niger Republic. We are constructing a refinery between the border of Nigeria and Katsina State. These things are on record. We are constructing roads to foreign countries. We are supplying electricity to Niger Republic, Benin Republic, and probably Togo. And look at the case of Nigeria. And we are pushing estimated billings on people. We just increased the value added tax from 5% to 7.5%. So where is the value for the people? Democracy is the government of the people, by the people, and for the people. You see, so, and that is why the crime rate is growing in the land. We are talking about unemployment. We are talking about almanjiris. We are talking about beggars. We are talking about, you know, ineffective employment opportunities. I mean, I was worried when we started reading, why should a master's degree holder be riding a power bike as a source of living? If that young man or that young lady were to be in an economy like the Singaporean economy, will she be riding on motorbikes? So I think our leaders in code have perfected the art of politicking, but they need to learn a lot about governance. There are principles of good governance, and the United Nations has simplified the future by putting it in the Sustainable Development Goals that will be benchmarked by year 2030. And it may surprise you that countries like Rwanda may be ahead of the expectations in terms of mileage. And here we are. And it's been predicted that our population is likely to be doubled by year 2050. So if we continue at this rate of seeking to mortgage the future, what happens in 2050 to Nigeria? I mean, I'm disturbed by the fact that the collapsing generation of power in Nigeria now is ascribed to gas. And yet, my great country has the largest deposit of proven gas in Africa. So this is a question of, you know, resourceful management of resources. So we need resourceful leaders that we maximize the overflowing blessings God has given us. And I, as a Nigerian, speaking for myself, I'm yet to see that resourceful leadership. But I look forward to it, because we may be helpless now, we are not hopeless.
Thank you very much, Pastor Jide Ologun, Public Affairs Analyst, for joining us on News on the Hour and for your contribution.
Thank you.